You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. It's been a couple of weeks since I've done a recording. I've since turned 34 since the last time I did a recording for this episode. So some may say older and wiser, some may say older and less technologically advanced, which is probably going to be the case when it comes to all these updates on Zoom and everything in between. On this edition, is quite possibly going to be the filthiest episode of the SWN podcast. In fact, that's something we promise here at SWN for this moment in time. Catch us back in about an hour or 69 minutes. and we'll see what happens. On this edition is currently one half of the FCW Tag Team Champions with Randy Valentine. It's the other half. It's filth. It's the filthy half itself. It's Rob. It's basically Robert Roode. Ryan Roode. Ryan Roode.
Uncle Bobby. That's what it is. Hi everyone. Hi.
Despite that incredible run up, then getting your name wrong. How are you doing?
I'm fantastic. This is what I'd suspect is absolutely scraping the bottom barrel of wrestlers that you've had to bring in. I saw that you've had. Judas, you've had Judas on, because I was listening to his podcast the other day. I saw you've had Grado on here as well, and now you've got me. What an absolute train wreck! But I'm here, and I will answer any questions you have. I'll also give you as any information if you want us to strip off, I'll strip off.
Well, okay, we'll see how it goes. Speaking of costings, I'm finding out this week how much wrestlers who've just been released by WWE cost to get on a podcast, and I'll tell you for something, I'll never get them on the podcast. It's amazing. but 289. This will be the 289th episode of the podcast. I think we're still getting the heavy hitters in here. We've got champions.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
One half of the Fair City Wrestling Tag Team Champions.
Of course.
So, usual icebreaker, the most cliched wrestling question I can ask a wrestler. How did you get into pro wrestling? How did you become a fan of wrestling?
I was a fan growing up as a child. A very big WWF fan in my early years. Big fan of Hulk Hogan. But I was a big fan of Hulk Hogan growing up. Absolutely despise the man now. But I was also a huge fan of tag team wrestling. It was kind of my thing. Legion of Doom specifically. Were my heroes. Hawk and Animal, absolutely incredible pair of wrestlers. Not so much outside the ring, but inside the ring, they were absolutely one of the best things I've ever seen, as well as the Bushwhackers as well. Because there was nothing like them at the time. There was a lot of things that were just kind of thrown together. I wasn't a big fan of, which will probably shock Randy, a big fan of Hulk Hogan and Randy Savage as a tag team. I wasn't a big fan of Randy Savage as a person either, or as a wrestler. I just found them very, very, very boring. But when you're younger, everyone wants to be a Hulkamaniac. And I wanted to be a Hulkamaniac because that was the thing to be. That's kind of how I first tiptoed into it. Like every young child, you know, WWF curtains and wallpaper and bedding and the what do you call them? They had used to have these big 12-inch figures, used to pull the cords on the back and used to and used to speak and they were terrible. But after that I didn't watch a lot of wrestling. After I think it was about 12, 13-ish. I didn't really get into the Attitude Era, I'm not gonna lie. I never really watched the Attitude Era a lot. I played the games on the PlayStation 1, fantastic, but I wasn't really a big Attitude Era fan. I didn't start getting back into wrestling until probably come up to 10 years ago. I didn't start by getting back into wrestling until I started wrestling again. It's not something I ever thought I'd get into. So before I started doing all this, I did a lot of mixed martial arts, a lot of K1 kickboxing, which would probably shock you being such a heavy set guy that I am. But I did have a huge accident during one of the inter shows, like inter club shows, where I took a big kick to the head. My jaw was broken. And it was just sort of like, a really, really bad case of the gurns, as it were. But after that, I got one of the guys just popped it back in with like a palette knife. And anyway, I couldn't go back to training. And it was just, you know, it was wrecked, because that was my entire thing. I went back to training for a couple of weeks, took another slight knock, and it was gone again. Yeah, it was not good. So, it was actually a friend of mine was out on a night out, and he bumped into two guys randomly in the middle of a nightclub, Ric Flair chopping each other. So there were just two guys absolutely off their nut and were just running up and just, woo, woo. And he went over because he was full of interest. And it turns out there were two wrestlers from Domains, and they were looking for big guy wrestlers. And that's how he got in contact with me. He went, I know you're probably not a big wrestling fan anymore. He went, but have you ever thought about trying it again? Or have you ever thought about just, you know, trying getting into it? And I absolutely hated the idea. Hated it. Coming obviously from a martial arts, like a mixed martial arts background, I didn't like the idea of going from physical contest to performance contest, as it were. But once I started getting into it, I loved it. I absolutely loved it. I think it took us a couple of years to get me first match. Yeah. And the first match, there's a story that kind of sticks with us, sticks in me memory over anything else. So the first match that I ever had was a tag team match, and it was absolutely diabolically awful. Right. And at the end of the match, I mean, the match was horrible. When I say horrible, I mean it was absolutely dog shit. Horrible. Hated it. But at the end, this little girl came up to us, and she must have been about 3 or 4 year old. And she come up and she gave us a really big hug. And she was like, it's all right, you'll get them next time, because you're my favorite. And from then on in, I was like, you know what it is? I was like, This is why people do it. This is why people do what we do. It's not for the money, although that is great. It's not for the boys in the back. It's not so much for yourself, but you just have to remember that somewhere out there is a little boy or a little girl or an adult or a big fan who's looking at you, doing what you do. And for that night, even if it's just for that night, you are their hero. And to me, that's what this business should always be about. Mm-hmm. And from then on in, I've always loved doing what I've done. Even if it's serious comedy, if I'm the bad guy, it doesn't matter. As long as they're having a good time, I'm having a good time. And that's what I love about this business and what we do.
I couldn't agree more with you from the fan side of things. It's always something you could always feel. If the wrestlers enjoying themselves or believing that what they're doing is entertaining, you can always tell when they don't as well, which can make for a very awkward experience for everyone else involved that's watching it and watching this thing unfold. So right, a lot to unpack in that bit there. So I'm gonna try and I don't want to go right back to the start and ask about the draw the drawstring figures.
Of course,
I've never
figures. Have you never seen them? So used to be like a two pack, and it was about yay big, yeah. So 12-inch figures, plastic, and there was a Hulk Hogan, and there was an Ultimate Warrior, and you used to have like a drawstring cord, and it would just be like, I'm the Hulkamaniac, I'm the Ultimate Warrior.
Let's see what I've got here. I'm just going to Google them. Oh, they're talking Hasbro figures.
That's the one. and it'll be a Hulk Hogan, and it'll be an Ultimate Warrior. There might be more, but that's the only two I had.
Oh, they look, that looks cool. That's it's just some giant Hasbro with a string on the back. Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Looks like there's a Roddy Piper one as well.
The voice feature doesn't board well over 20 odd years. So no. I pull it now, just kind of just go, and that's probably not as much as it does.
I'm not going to ask you to show me it, but have you still got it? Are you one to keep here?
I've got it somewhere. I don't have it here, I don't think. But I do still have them. But what I'll do is I will hunt them down and I'll show you them. I'll show you what's left of them.
So even though you fell out of wrestling early teens, you know, when you find football and girls and all course, that kind of stuff, you know. Nay, snards, nay me. I battered through. I didn't care about making friends, clearly. So you still kept, even though subconsciously you kept a hold of them, you were still a little Hulkamaniac inside, even though, you know, nowadays it's definitely not cool to be
Hulkamaniac.
At all. So you took your break from watching. It was just a case of that. You just grew up and went, my friends aren't watching this, I'm not watching this.
Yeah. There was no one that really... So it's like you said, everyone was playing football. Everyone was football or gym or, you know, like you say, girls and nights out and drinking and stuff like that. So it was never really something that socially I wanted to do, because I would have just been literally by myself, because there was no one else around. I mean, there might have been, but there was no one that I knew personally that would still indulge in wrestling, as it were. But everything just kind of changed. Everything went more football, and I wasn't really a huge football fan. I'm still not really a huge football fan, but I just kind of rolled with what the fad was at the time, and it's just kind of how life is, really, I suppose. But then, like I say, every now and again, on secretly on the PlayStation 1, WWF, was it the Attitude, one where you can make them bleed and stuff?
Yeah,
which one it was called?
There's Attitude and there's Warzone. Apparently, one's worse than the other.
Yeah, Warzone's the one I remember, which you could make them bleed. So I'd still be a fan in secret, but it wouldn't be as hardcore as it used to be. Except I didn't really watch that much. I picked this up in bits and pieces later on in life, but I wasn't a huge fan at the time, which was a shame, because the Attitude Era was probably its biggest. Wrestling was probably at its biggest during the Attitude Era. Everyone that I know seems to come in and praises the Attitude Era as its you know, as WWS or WWE's glory days, but I missed loads of it. I missed absolutely loads of it.
It's weird though, like you're talking about that. How often? It's not something you do. You go up to make a pal. As using that vernacular, there goes, I haven't made that many friends since. But making a pal, it's really not something you go up to go and do you like the wrestling, because immediately you go, oh, that fake stuff, that rubbish, and all that kind of stuff, and it just drives it back further and further into your little secret.
Yeah. Do you like watching men greased up in little pants? Do you?
Yeah, okay. Fighting over a belt and they're not wearing
trousers. Yeah.
You know,
you like them touching each other? A little bit. What's it
mean? I know, exactly. Yeah, just leave me and my fetishes alone.
I'm a demon.
So again, into the MMA world, which, to be honest, is more touching man than anything else. But you know, getting into the mixed martial arts world, was that kind of you had this little secret wrestling thing with the PlayStation. You wanted to do that kind of physicality kind of thing with getting into the gym and all that stuff. Was there a little bit in there just going, well, I'm not going to be a wrestler, or this wrestling's not for me, but I still want to do something like physical like that?
I still wanted to do something physical. Like I say, everyone was doing something different. So there's basketball, football. There was a lot of guys, especially because when I was growing up, I wasn't from a particularly nice area of the Northeast. And it was just common thing to do, you know, to start doing some sort of physical training or something like that, just in case, you know, anything happens, as it were. And I got into jiu-jitsu and K1 kickboxing. And it's kind of just all kind of all just sort of evolved from there. But with wrestling, because it's very, very niche, or so I thought it was very niche, there was nowhere advertised that was a school that I knew of. There was nowhere advertised. I didn't even know shows existed until I started stepping into this world. And now it turns out that the northeast of England has got about 50 different promotions in such a small, compact area, which I didn't even know. Nothing, there was nothing around that I was aware of to even start that road. So I always had to do something.
It's incredible. I mean, when you started then, it was just on that cusp of kind of the big boom of British wrestling, because we'd have had the insane Fight Club documentary. Progress were starting pretty much, and Rev Pro were doing well, and all these kind of promotions were just booming. And then you've kind of just came in just under all that happened. Yep. When you did eventually, when your mate did break you down, and you eventually went to go and give this a go, kind of thing. Bar than finding out that you actually love it despite your rotten first match. Just when you took to the training, did you realise then how physical it was? Were you expecting it to be as physical as it was?
Yeah, and I also found out how insanely homoerotic it can get. I don't think until I started wrestling I hadn't had as many male appendages around my face or neck as much in my life. To be fair, even doing MMA and stuff like that, you know, all right, today we're going to do head scissors. Oh, today we're going to do hurricanranas. Yeah, I mean, horrible. But it is what it is. On the first session that we did, there was just this little tiny little box room in the South Shields, in the coast of England. And it was the smallest little box room you could barely roll. And it was that small. And it was about eight little, you know, those foam jigsaw mats. Mm-hmm. So eight of those in a crash mat. And the crash mat had seen better days. There was no padding in the center of it. There was padding around the outside because it had just been slammed to death. And on the first day, the guy he wanted to do spine busters. So first day, oh, it can't be that bad. On Anderson, bam, straight with that. Ah. And I couldn't move, and it was just like from there on in, I was like, that was probably one of the worst things I've ever taken in my life, but I want to do it again. And it kind of it just sort of evolved from there. So spine busters, what else did we do? So because the guy that was teaching me, he had this thing. So with the whole, like every other wrestling session, it was formatted. Beginner stuff. And then right at the very end, he'd go, is there anything anyone wants to try? And it was just someone going, oh yeah, I want to do spine busters. All right, okay, I have six variations of spine busters. You can all take one if you want. Yeah, okay. Pop-ups, sit-outs, landing on your knees, Arn Anderson style. And I think I must have took two or three, but the Arn Anderson specifically, I'll never ever forget it, because I hit that crash mat and there was no padding in the middle. And honestly, I thought me insides were going to squeeze up me arse like toothpaste. It was absolutely vile. It was the worst thing I've ever experienced in my life. And I've never taken one since. So if anyone watching this, don't you dare come to me with a spine buster, because it's not going to happen. I can tell you that now, right? I want to keep me insides on the inside.
But pull the old Hulk Hogan card. Just going, that doesn't work for me, brother. No.
It doesn't work for me, brother.
We will just do anything else other than that. So when I was doing the old cage match research, as I always do, it says here that your debut was actually 2015 in a Rumble. So we found out that the Germans are wrong, which, you know, not for the first time in life. Was as Ryberg.
Oh, God, man, no. We don't talk about him. He died. Don't talk about him.
That was the one thing. That was the one thing you don't want to talk about.
So when I first started, I didn't have a gimmick. Like most new guys into the scene, I didn't have a gimmick whatsoever. Also, fuck cage match, because it's wrong. It's missed out loads of matches. It's missed out most of my career, so I can get shot on. But so and Ryberg. So I didn't have a gimmick, and my whole thing when I first broke into the company, I was essentially ringside security. So I was a pretty big guy, and my friend that got me into the scene, started off paying my dues, and we were essentially security. So, you know, just make sure no fans rush the rings and things like that. And then what transpired is we're doing some training, and we're trying to think of we're doing like a character development sort of like a seminar. It was not long after we'd done a big official seminar with UNG Maggie. That goes shows how long I've known Ewan. And we're talking about characters. And I didn't have a name. I couldn't think of a name, couldn't think of a character, because you know how does that thought process go? Someone was saying, oh, you're a big guy, like Ryback. Oh, we'll call you Ryback. And I was like, all right, okay. And I thought, well, that's horrible. And then they were like, oh, do you want to do what was I learning? A jackknife? Yeah, a jackknife. And I'm like, all right, well, you're going to be like Goldberg, aren't you? But you're going to be like the fat version. And I'm like, all right, okay. But you're going to be Ryberg. So from there on in, I was known as Ryberg or Ryberg Security. And I was in a tag team called Rad Pro Security. And we're essentially just two big guys in security t-shirts, in shorts, that would go and take out the bad guys of the out of the ring and things like that. It kind of evolved from there. The gimmick didn't last that long, thankfully. I hate it so much. I hate that it existed. Horrible, horrible. But if it wasn't, it's one of those things. If it didn't happen, then I wouldn't be where I was now. So in one hand, I am thankful that Ryberg Security did exist, because I did do a lot of development under that horrible, 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 horrible name. But from there on in, that's when I started developing the Ryan Roode character from that point. I think it was maybe 2-3 years as Ryberg. I'm not too sure. And then Ryan Roode was the more of the heel side of things I wanted to do.
So we won't labour on Ryberg too much, because it's clearly triggered off some PTSD.
Some trauma, yeah. But I've still got the gear somewhere as well, somewhere.
Be next to Hulk Hogan. But talking about like not having a character, or not even thinking the process of that, even when playing the games, did you not have, like, do you not create yourself and
You could make a custom character, but I mean the storyline, like the storytelling on the games weren't exactly putting edge in the PS1 days. I mean, even now 2K struggle, you know, just with like voice lines on their games. But I don't know. I wasn't much of an actor. In fact, I know I'll not tell you on there, but the first couple years under Ryberg, I didn't speak. I did not speak at all. I was mute all the way through it. I was the quiet member of, the tag team. I didn't have a voice.
Which seems incredible when you're saying that for the first 2-3 years, or that you didn't really have this kind of, I don't want to say imagination, but you didn't have this kind of thought of a character and all that. And then Ryan Roode is all character. You know, it is such a explosive, colourful.
Ryan Roode came by absolute chance. I'm not gonna lie, it came by absolute luck, and it's kind of just all developed from there. So there was a charity show I got asked to do a couple of years later, which was for an event called Rock for Mick, and it was for one of our friends, one of my wrestling friends, and his best friend had passed away. So they'd done a charity show for that. And the first thing he asked me is, when I can only get 5 or 6 guys on, but I'm going to have to give them something to do. He went, is there any chance you can do heel? And I went, shit. Yeah. Okay. I'll try it. I'd never done heel at that point. I never tried it. And then there was some point during the show, there'd been a bit of a lull in between matches. And I just happened by chance to be backstage. And the guy went, I need someone to cut for time. Can you do a promo? Hand us the mic, threw us out there, and I blacked out. I blacked out completely. But apparently apparently from what I've been told, I can't remember exactly what happened, But from what I was told, I gave a 10-15 minute promo, and it was one of the funniest, stupidest promos. And I was sitting on people's laps. I was lap dancing girls. I was calling people Frodo. I was giving it beans. And from there on in, they went, you need to do that all the time. And I was, it all just sort of developed from there. And then that's when I was backstage. And before the match, so I didn't have a name for the heel character. I couldn't be Ryberg still. And one of the guys like, oh, you look like Bobby Roode, but fat. You know, it's a weird thing that people keep doing that. Oh, you look like Goldberg, you know, but fat. Oh, you look like Bobby Roode, but fat. So that's how we're going to do it. So now you're going to be called Ryan Roode. And I went, all right, okay. And that's how Ryan Roode come about. It was just by pure luck. If I wasn't backstage and he hadn't given me that mic, I'd have no idea where my character development or how things would have panned out from there on in.
So how did you go from there then? So Ryan Roode, you blacked out. You did a 10-15 minute promo where you were filthy. Let's say that. So from that point onwards, did you start going, right, what, Google, I don't know if you want to Google filthy, but like Google things to try and build the character into.
Yeah. So from there on in, I had to try and find a way of, essentially your character is just your personality, but turned up to 11. Now I was always being this character, or this person that I am. With the shitty one-liners and stuff like that. The things that make people laugh, and that's fine. But I didn't know how to do that and then portray that as a character. Because the way people sort of see a person, and then their wrestling gimmick is, you are this person, and then your gimmick is your mask. But I couldn't do that. They both had to be the same thing. And that's the only thing that worked for me. So from there on in, I was looking for guys that would do something similar. Old Rick Roode stuff. Val Venus. To some degree, I suppose quite a lot before he was, you know, Joey Ryan. So those were the sort of guys I then started to look into, and then the character developed more and more and more and more from there. And I just started slowly pushing the board out. The more tongue-in-cheek sort of things I would bring out before shows or during the show, and just see how far I could push the boat out without overstepping the mark.
I was about to say, because I think for wrestling, anyway, you can get away with a hell of a lot.
Absolutely.
In a good way. I know you've just mentioned a string of names who are well and truly cancelled, but...
Absolutely.
But there's a limit, there's a line that you can hit in wrestling that's a bit further than you think it is. Like the grinding on grannies or whatever you do. It's like, oh, it's part of the show. It's a good
bit. Fantastic.
But between all that, so you're 5 years in, or so into wrestling. Just to take a sidebar here, how were you of the scene when she started? Did you start exploring other companies about, or do you just kind of play on with your own training?
I kind of just stuck where I was. I suppose like everyone else, when you first start wrestling, you need to plant your feet somewhere that you feel comfortable with, people that you feel comfortable with, which is what people generally always do anyway. The problem with things like that, I didn't learn until a lot later, is staying in one place to train doesn't always work for everyone, because if you're only learning for one person, you're only learning one style of wrestling. So it pays to travel around, and then you can develop more as a person. But when I first started, I stayed at the same company for years and years and years, until it kind of self-destructed on itself. But But I would always recommend moving around. If anyone has any worries about changing schools or training elsewhere, please don't. Always look for other schools. Always learn other styles. It'll pay off massively for your development as a wrestler.
I mean, last thing you want is have 10 trainees that are all learning the same thing, and that means they're going to put on the same exact same matches for 5 matches in a row as well. Yeah. So for yourself, when you did start doing that, was there any particular seminars or that you wanted to use that would help your own development as Ryan Roode?
I was just kind of taking seminars that were coming. Well, that were put towards us. So you and G Mackey, I did a couple of his, way back when. I mean, there's a couple more as well. Again, all cancelled guys, now. But do you really want us to drop these names, Billy? Do you want us to drop these names?
I mean, you can, but it's pretty. Yeah, if you want to.
Yes, I mean, so you and Darkside, James Scott, multiple times at seminars with him. El Ligero, a couple of those as well. Yeah. It just gets worse and worse the more I go on. But I also did some, I did some great seminars as well. One of the best seminars I've ever done was with Tyler Bate over the past couple of years, which was absolutely invaluable. He was such a great guy as well. But early days, again, I was just sort of, I didn't know what to look for in the ways of I didn't know what to look for in the ways of what seminar would help me develop. All I knew is I could do a certain style of it. So I'd look for guys that could teach me certain things. So I'd look for guys that were either more of my build or had similar interests as the way I want to develop as a character. I mean, not in the horrible way that that's panned out, but in the way that I wanted it to work.
Yes, yeah. You're looking for big guys. Big guys.
I don't want tips how to do what they did, but yeah.
I know that was an incredible list. It just got worse. I'm sure there's some names that you haven't even.
It literally got worse. It was. There's a fair few. Like I said, Tyler Bate was probably one of my favorite ones.
And he is safe. He's nice and safe. Yes, he is safe.
Nathan Cruz was also a great guy as well. There's a few. I'm trying to think of which ones aren't on a notorious list, and there's few. There's a few of them.
That's right. We'll move on then. We'll move on. If Ryberg didn't absolutely kill you, then the list of Roggins,
might just do it.
So moving on from that point, you did start venturing out of Tiny Weir a little bit, and how did you find that? So you developed this character, Ryan Roode, filthy Ryan Roode. People were receptive to it. Did you find that you had to make any adjustments going to other places that you had to? Was there places that you could do it, but maybe tweak it so it was face? How was your kind of development with that?
The thing with Ryan Roode is when people watch the way I did Ryan Roode, I would always be booked as a heel. It's very, very rare, up until recently when I started doing this with Randy, that you would see me as a face, for example. It's quite difficult to do a Ryan Roode character as well. I always thought it was difficult to do a Ryan Roode character as a face. I thought it would be impossible until I started dipping my toes into the more comedy-esque style of doing things, which I don't think it was until I managed to step in the ring with Grado, and we were trying to plan a match. So there was a six-man match. It was me, Jack Jester, and Chris Renfrew. And we're wrestling three other guys. A guy called Paulie C, a guy called Boogs, and Grado. And as we were playing the match, everyone was stressing with each other because nothing made sense. But they were trying to make a lot of logic in the way of how a face and a heel sort of match works. And then Grado was just kind of sitting there, and he was just making stupid suggestions, really. And then Jester started getting annoyed at him. And he just went, you know what it is? He went, fuck it. It's funny. We'll just do it. And I sat there and I went, what a notion. Like, what a thought process. When everyone's thought about like wrestling logic, fuck it. It's funny. We'll do it. And from then on in, I was like, well, maybe we'll try the comedy approach. Maybe people will be more receptive to a comedy approach. And then from there on in, Ryan Roode then developed again to a different style of different style of wrestling, I suppose, the comedy style of wrestling. And people seem to be very receptive of the comedy style of wrestling. So when I did, if I did heel, I would be a very mouthy comedy-esque heel. And it would sort of water us down to an acceptable level of tongue-in-cheek filth, as it were. It also, the very, very few times I'd be booked as face, which was, God, once in 20 shows, maybe at best, I would do very, very slight comedy-esque stuff and would still, you know, give the crowd the flavour of what I'm all about, but also still be socially acceptable. If that makes sense. Yeah.
I do have the note of your match with in that six man with Bredo. So of course I do. I'm a Scottish wrestling podcast. I was going to have that written down anyway. Yeah. But working with Bredo, it sounds, yeah, it was just kind of, fuck it. He's a guy that's kind of, I don't know how, but he's always seems to have got a pulse with the crowd quite well. Yeah. I don't know if whether that was something that he kind of not, maybe not rubbed off onto you, because that would be absolutely, we're talking about homoerotic anyway. But but from that point onwards, you said that kind of thought, that notion, is that kind of how you brought maybe some of your matches forward, where you did think of if you were the heel or the face, you go, ah, fuck it, you know?
Absolutely. So it would get to a point where I didn't really want to do, I didn't want to take wrestling. I still wanted wrestling to be serious. I still wanted to take wrestling seriously. I still wanted to train. I still wanted to do everything by the book. But at the same time, why can't we have fun while we're doing it? Why can't we enjoy what we do? Why does it always have to be a chore? Why does everyone have to bite each other's head off? Why do people have to hate each other backstage? When at the end of the day, if the crowd's having a good time, then I'm having a good time. And if I'm having a good time, the crowd's having a good time. And that's how I wanted to be as a person. Because that's the way I always saw how Grado did things. If he was having a good time, the crowd was having a good time. If the crowd was having a good time, he would feed off their energy and he would be, he would just sort of transform into the best version of Grado we could possibly be. If he's laughing, they're laughing. If they're laughing, he's laughing. And that is an absolute best way to look at wrestling this far into the game. If you're having a good time, they're having a good time, and vice versa.
And it also saves your body. Because
at
the end of the day, like, you know, I mean, unless you're in a particular promotion that prides itself on mat wrestling or anything like that, that you have to do catch and all that kind of stuff, generally, your family-friendly shows, your shows that are just the kids have dragged their parents to, they're not going to care about if you're doing a six-minute wrist lock, all these counters and all that kind of stuff. Know what they're going to care about? You know, the big lad that takes a lollipop and throws it in the other guy's mouth, they're going to remember that, and they're going to think it's amazing.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
So it's, I mean, I'm a story guy for it. I've found out in doing these podcasts that I'm not a wrestling guy, I'm a story guy. Give me something to latch on to, and something like that would be my thing. Grado probably being the perfect example is you could tell me, I could watch a whole match of Grado's, maybe 10 minutes, which would be lucky. 10 minutes, and I could probably name you three moves that happened in it, you know, that kind of way, but you know that you were thoroughly entertained. So, I mean, this doesn't work for everyone. Some people are wrestlers, and they should be wrestlers, but if you can latch onto a character that people enjoy, whether it's taboo or to cheer, then just do it, you know, save your body.
Yeah.
You only get one.
Exactly.
Depending on your faith or credence, you may get several more, but generally you're going to get one. So moving forward then, I'm just going to jump quite a big way to Fair City Wrestling. Was that your first Scottish, your trip across the border? Was that your first time? Or?
No. W3L was my first trip with Mike Musso. And I did a couple of shows for Mike. Nothing major. Did a couple of Seven Sins and things like that.
Oh, right.
A couple of shows like that for him, and a couple of you know, just filler matches here and there. Nothing major. But it was actually through W3L that I met Kev, Commissioner Williams, basically. And that's how I met Kev, and me and Kev had a match together, and it was amazingly fun. Kev was still doing his he's like the Super Nintendo stuff.
Yeah, Super Wrestling Entertainment System.
That's the one. And we did a whole match around Kev. What did he do? He rode the ref like Yoshi, and he had this little Yoshi egg, and he rode the ref around the ring, and then was hitting us with clotheslines and stuff like that. And it was such a fun match, and me and Kev just clicked. And that's kind of how we got talking. This was like maybe a year and a half before I even knew FCW existed. And it was Kev that messaged us out of the blue. You know, I want you to be involved. I want to bring you in. And that was the start of the FCW journey.
And it just by happens by chance at that point. And that Ewan was heavily involved in that. Actually, I've got the match in front of me now. So it's a gala. It's not. Anyway, doesn't matter. Ewan was heavily involved with WPL for a very long time. So again, another connection that you've kind of redeveloped. Mm-hmm. You always kind of still have that relationship with Ewan between that point and when you had that first game, was some guy.
When Ewan used to come down quite a lot for different promotions down our ways, I'd always speak to him. He stayed down here quite a lot with a couple of friends of mine when he was doing shows down our ways. And I've spoken to Ewan over the years many, many times over many various things. And I've always liked Ewan. He's a great guy.
So back to Fair City then. So Fair City Wrestling, yeah. they bring you in. We have a couple. What have we got? Debut 2021. Is that right?
Yes.
Let's see. First contact. So one of their, it would be the Bonner Hall. That'd be right, tag team match.
Yeah. Oh God. Yeah. That show.
That was that show.
The infamous show.
Yes.
Great show, mate. Good show, mate. Fantastic. But yeah, that one.
That was when. It's been talked about to death. It'll be fine. I'll mention it. But that was the time where Fair City was really kind of having their roster. Was a lot of guys from Dundee, and they pulled up quite a lot from the Northeast, your Arcadians and things like that. As a unit. So it was yourself, Ewan Mackey, who we've mentioned here, and Thaddeus Vogue and Zach Leon on the other side. He stepped away from the wrestling not long ago.
That's a shame.
So Bonner Hall then, Dundee. Yeah, you know, let's talk about. So this is the one that the fire alarm was tripped by allegedly somebody that we won't mention, allegedly.
I don't know the name.
That's probably for the best for this moment in time. to think that you're at your first Fair City show, that Kev brings you in, he wants you involved in this promotion.
And
the first show you're on, the main event gets interrupted by a fire alarm. It was, I mean, I don't know how much of that kind of stuff you've seen before. When it comes to shows, I'm sure as a wrestler, you've seen plenty of backstabbing and all that kind of stuff and snidiness. But how was that on the scale of things to have to be interrupted by a fire alarm?
I've never seen anything handled so. Fantastically, I've never seen anything. I mean, the most I've seen from down my ways is pettiness. Someone will rip a poster out here and there and things like that. But I've never experienced whatever I've experienced in Bonner Hall before. Again, it was a fantastic show. It was a really good show with great people. The one thing I do remember vividly about that show is what made us love FCW so much. Because there's not many promotions that I'm deathly loyal to, but FCW is one of them. And the thing that, once that fire alarm was pulled and everyone went outside and everyone was in the car park, and there was, like I say, there was young children, there was people in prams, there was elderly people, it was ridiculous. But the wrestlers come out, I think was it Caleb Valhalla? Yeah, it was Caleb Valhalla and little Chrissy Forbes.
Looking sharp.
And he was sitting on Caleb's shoulders and he was chanting FCW, and the crowd were eating it up, and they were all chanting along. And that, just even though what had happened and it was being dealt with further down the road, the spirits were still high with all the workers that were there. It was like the backstage, the bonding and spirit between everyone backstage was absolutely fantastic. And the people that were, even though they were standing in the rain with the young children, and obviously there was a couple that weren't happy with it, the atmosphere and the community aspect of between the wrestlers that come out, they still keep the guys entertained. And the crowd was phenomenal. I'd never experienced anything like that either. I mean, it was a huge, it was a big shitbaggy thing for that person to do. But on the other side of things, it was an absolutely fantastic round of support between the workers that were still on the show and the fans that had turned up for the show. It was a pivotal moment, I would have felt, for any promotion that had just experienced what they just experienced.
And that's how you create loyal, not just loyal wrestlers like for yourself, but also creates loyal fans that they still did that. They still made sure everyone was entertained, and even though they couldn't actually watch some wrestling or they had to wait for however long it was, they were still getting involved. They were getting pictures with the wrestlers. They were getting chatting.
Yeah,
it was just
yeah.
It sounds like that whoever did do it, allegedly, they kind of made the biggest misstep they could have done, because all it did was create this bigger tight-knit unit of
absolutely
fans.
Absolutely.
They bonded over this one chaotic moment. So Fair City Wrestling became quite a regular haunt for Ryan Roode. And the match, you mentioned Caleb. I'm a big fan of Caleb. You may not be aware of this in previous, like a few of the podcasts, but I think Caleb's just a wonderful human and amazing character.
Handsome man.
Stupid sexy Caleb. And then he got his hair cut, and I was like, oh, God, you're even more handsome. I hate this.
Man. Man, stop it. Stop it.
I know, getting hot and flustered, and we haven't went through the questions that you've received yet.
So
going in with Caleb, and look at the points you did have. It was quite an eclectic mix. You had Caleb, you had Dickie Divers, you had Sebastian Asher. It was three very different styles, very different wrestlers. So for yourself, do you thrive on that way that you get to mix it up with different kind of styles and opponents, and you can kind of mix in your filthy antics in with that, and just how do you operate with that?
Well, it's the same rules apply in the ring as it does in the bedroom, right? You have to adapt and overcome with your partner. So Caleb is a big strong man. Yeah. So I had to use a little more subtle techniques to make when I wrestled him a really, really memorable match. Hulk Hogan versus Caleb the Giant, which is what we titled the match. It's the same with Dickie Divers was the only match I've done there that has been 100% serious all the way through, and it was actually one of my favorite matches I've had and ever, to be fair, honest. Dickie Divers is a fantastic worker and a fantastic person just to plan anything with. And Sebastian Asher is a little shithead, right? But I don't like him. Nah, I'm only joking, Bobby. I love you, really. But it's you don't just have to read your opponent. You also have to read the room and see what gets over with everyone. I could do a lot of comedy with Caleb because he is a big guy, but he also he loves to laugh. He loves to laugh. So it was very easy to mix something up in between with him. Divers, I'm not going to lie, I shit my pants when Kev came to me, because I can't remember who I was supposed to wrestle someone else, but they dropped out, and it was just a spur of the moment, and Kev came up to me and went, right, you're working Divers tonight, and my arse just went, and I had no idea what to do, because Dive had said someone had, on the independent circuit, I'd been watching, you know, ICW, I think it was MEW down my side of things. I saw him various places, and I thought, holy fuck, he's really good. I don't know if I've got it in as the pull, like a really good matchup with him. And we did. Well, we actually had one of my favorite matches I've had in a long, long time, and I would do that 100 times over. And Bobby, oh, I love Bobby so much. Sebastian Asher, he's very open and very receptive, you know, in more ways than one. But he's very open, receptive to do, he's just to try something stupid. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, so fuck, it's funny. You know, so what, it's funny. And that's kind of how I made it work with those three specifically. But Divers was absolutely one of my squeaky bum moments. Like, but it was easily one of my favorite matches of all time.
I mean, we've got plenty of things we could cover, things like your time in SFW Heavyweight Champion, which, to be honest, sounds like the most perfect thing for Filth and Ryan Roode. But we're going to talk about Retro Filth, because of course we are. But current Fair State Wrestling Tag Team Champions, and this will be very awkward if you don't win on the 19th, and as we're chatting. But team, so eventually you faced Retro Randy first. And then you saved him from a beatdown, and you became Retro Filth. So meeting Randy for the first time, was it just, did it all make sense? Was it like a star-crossed lovers meeting across the ring as your eyes met?
Yeah, there was a lot of sexual tension. We went in for a hug, and there was definitely a little point of docking between us. But Randy, I'd never met anyone like Randy before. I knew Randy stepped away from wrestling a long, long time ago, and he's just made his comeback. So firstly, when I first met him, I thought, fuck, Randy's a lot older than I thought he was. And I thought, shit, he's a lot smaller than I thought he was. But Randy, like all the other guys up there, is very, very open and very receptive, and he's got such a great mind about what he does and how he makes things work, how he gets his character across. Because everyone knows Randy's very, very vocal, very, very vocal, and he loves to talk, and I love that. I love that Randy is 100% a gimmick guy, and he's as good as he is in ring, he's also fantastic as a character. Retro Randy is a fantastic all rounder. I would say anyway. I'm very, very curious of how Retro Filth is going to play out going forward. What's the next step for Retro Filth? Where we go from here? Because I mean, it's at the minute it's open challenge season, baby. You know what I mean? And it's just fun to see where this court's rolling.
But yeah, you're talking about Randy being very vocal. I think we chatted for near 2 hours, and I may have asked 4 questions.
Didn't surprise us.
But he had all the compliments for you. He had that kind of same tail end of it as well, going, he doesn't know what's going to happen, but you know, he's just going to enjoy it as it happens. He does have a question that he's put in on the Instagram. Ryan, your chest is ridiculously smooth in the SWN promo pic. Now you're like a shag pile rug. Did you stop shaving because of itchiness, or because you were bankrupting yourself in razors and shaving cream?
Veet is expensive, Randy, right? It is very, very expensive. Do you know how many bottles I have to get through to wax my back alone? Do you have any idea just to Veet me back? It's 2 whole fucking tubes, Randy. 2. And that's just me back. Now, if you factor in, I feel like I'm doing Rick Steiner math, right? But if you factor in, that's 2 tubes on your back. Maybe possibly 3 on my front. 2 on my legs. Maybe 3 more on my arse alone, you know what I mean? That's 10 tubes, you know? That's nearly a fiver a tube. It's expensive. And my body hair grows very, very rapidly. Very, very rapidly. You only get paid so much, Randy. Wrestling alone doesn't cover my wheat bills.
So speaking of tag team, then of course you are Fair City Wrestling Tag Team Champions, beat the Foundation in the future to become to have that accolade. This isn't your first rodeo with the tag team wrestling. You had Nikki Starr, you had Bruce Alicious as a couple of examples. As far as this goes, retro filth, you get to play out your PC, but not so PC Hulk Hogan fantasies with the old boas and what have you. How does retro filth rank in the old tag team mind of Ryan Roode?
Retro Filth is one of the most fun tag teams I've ever been in. It's also it's the second face tag team. It's the only tag. Sorry, it's only the face tag team I've been in where I've been Ryan Roode. The only other time I was in a face tag team, I was still Ryberg, and we don't talk about Ryberg.
We don't talk about Ryberg.
We don't talk about him. He's dead. He's dead. Don't talk about him. He's dead.
We've learned our lesson with Ryberg, so we'll just
But Randy is a lot of fun. He's a lot of fun.
So we've got more questions in, so I'll just start going around the houses with them. So Patrick Kutierski, he has asked, got a couple here. What's your favorite type of chair in a hotel room?
it's a special type of chair. It's usually found at the bottom of the bed, sometimes facing the window. Usually, you know, if you've got a partner over, or someone, a lady of the night, or you know, whatever you want to call them, sometimes it's fun just to have someone watch. So if there's a certain chair in a hotel room, that's made specifically. If you go to any hotel room, you might have one. Recently, I had two. So if I wanted to get a second watcher, you can do what they want. It's aptly named the cook chair. And that is my favorite style of chair.
Wonderful. And that actually makes me more afraid of the next question. The PS, the offer from Cairn Douglas that I still stands if you're keen. Winking smiley.
Absolutely. If we get one with two chairs, we can get me and NS, not safe for mums, all in one room. We'll arrange something. We'll arrange something, boys.
Let that seep into your mind as you listen to this podcast. Right, so what else have we got? We've got more on the Instagram, and then we can dive into your filth bag of questions that you've got. Right, these are nice kind of professional questions. RNM2679 has asked, why is he so filthy and freaky?
Oh, man. A lifetime of mental torture, I suppose. A lot of traumas. I've got a very heavy set pair of testicles, which often controls parts of my brain. It's a lot to do with hormones, you know.
Ryberg time of not talking. You just let it all out, and it just came out as
that. Yes. It comes out in a blast, or it comes out in a slow seat.
Oh, it's always the way. IB Scotty has asked, any guys or girls you've wrestled or seen to keep an eye on, north or south? North and south, sorry.
There's a fair few. Scotty himself, weird enough. A couple of members from Redgate. There's the guys, they're not safe for mums. There's Kane and Dan now. I want to keep an eye on. I think the pair of them have got a lot of potential to do great things. I do like Redgate. They've been one of my most favourite opponents as of late. From down my ways, there's so many. I couldn't name them all. But from Scotland, it's definitely Redgate, and it's definitely not safe for mums.
Are you finding down your way? I'm finding like the Northeast is just, it's one of those real hotbeds.
Oh,
I was gonna say hotbeds of wrestling. I don't know. I mean,
oh yeah, that as well. There's a lot in the Northeast. There's loads in the Northeast. I'm trying to think of a couple of guys that's worth keeping an eye on. I can't remember my names off the top of my head.
Is one of those ways that you actually remember their real name? And you're like, I can't.
Yeah.
Neither.
Yes.
Fair.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a guy called Henry Faust, which I wrestled. He's someone to keep an eye on. He's actually fantastic. Very, 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 very hard hitting. He's been on a couple of North shows down my end, but he's someone that everyone should be keeping an eye on, because I do believe he's going to be going places.
So let's do this. Let's get into the bag, into the old Roode sack. And I don't have the questions, so these will all be very much surprises to me. What did you get?
Right. These are all anonymous, so I don't have any names. But here we go. Worst championship belt design. It's going to be the 24/7 design. I hate it. It was horrible. And the worst. It's not that I had an issue with 24/7 belts as a whole. Anyway, I mean, the belt was horrible. It was green. It was just boring looking. But there seemed to be the surge of when that came out. Everyone seemed to have a variation of a 24/7 title, and everyone's doing a 24/7 storyline, and just the whole thing was just a mess. And I just didn't enjoy. I didn't enjoy anything about it. Someone put Retro Filth and the Meat Factory should join forces and create a faction called Filthy Meats.
There we go.
Yeah.
And Craig Berry and John Kerr and all you four just together in a big foursome. Someone will like it.
So, I mean, there'll be a lot of meat slapping meat. You know what I mean? Right. I mean, you know, yeah. In more ways than one. But right, so who would I wrestle on FCW that I haven't already? Again, Dan or Ken, I would love to wrestle. And also Tom Atlas. I've never wrestled Tom Atlas. I do really notice. I love Tom Atlas so much. Little sweetheart that he is, but I'd also love to punch his little head in.
There it is.
You know, it's a very, very, very aggressive type of love. Very, you know what I mean? I would just like to just hold him closely and then just, you know, break his neck or something. But he's an absolute sweetheart. I would.
It's smother.
Choke him out.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. I mean, I would tell them there's a safe word, but then put me headphones in so I couldn't hear them. If I found a dead body in a hotel room, what would I do? First thought, I'd make someone else a suspect. Again, probably Tom Atlas, because, you know, bye, Tom. Randy Valentine, Patrick, and Kane, Shag, Snog, and Kill.
Oh, I thought... sorry, hang on. You kind of didn't leave a pause between the dead body thing before you just went Retro Randy, Patrick, Kane, Shag.
Oh, right.
And I thought, all right, okay, this is gone. This right. Went a different way. Anyway,
well,
so...
Right. Well, so, what we're doing, Billy, is we're planning a crime. That's what we're doing.
Right, okay, cool.
Me and you, we're planning a crime right now. Right. This doesn't get ahead. We're planning a crime. So yeah, dead body in a hotel. I'd make someone else a suspect. Probably Tom Atlas, because, you know, bye, Tom.
Yeah.
Pause.
Randy, yeah, pause. Question. Okay, right.
Randy, Patrick, Kane, Shag, Snog, Kill. You know, I'd Snog Patrick, because I think you'd be a very generous kisser, right? Shit. Shag Randy, because there's already tension. Oh, and I can't kill Kane, can I? Like, all three of them are getting all three at once, right? I'm going to snog them first. I'm going to shag them all to death. I think that's the only respectable way I can answer that.
I'm glad you went for shag first, then death at the end. I think that's that.
Oh, yeah. Yes, yeah. I mean, unless... No, never mind. We'll snog them first, shag them, then kill them. We'll not deviate from that order. Top five Scots to wrestle. Caleb Valhalla, I would love to have another singles match with Caleb. I absolutely love the guy to bits. Dickie Divers, again, he was easily one of my favourite matches I've ever had. I'm going to put obviously Grado on the list. I've worked him in a tag. I would love to work on solos. I've never done that. And I think just from outside of that, again, Tom Atlas, he's coming up leaps and bounds. I would absolutely love to work Tom. And the other one, who, other than Divers, I was watching as I was coming up, was Aspen Faith, and I'd quite like the rest of Aspen Faith, just to see what comes of that, because he seems quite a hard hitting guy, and I would be very much curious to see how that plays out, because if I was managed to get the match I did out of Divers, I think Aspen would push us just to a different level as well. So, yeah. So that's me five.
I love that I haven't instigated an Aspen Faith mention on this podcast, but it's happened anyway. That's always always good for me.
I'm watching you. what is my maximum wank count? It's five, anything after that, and it's just powdered milk. Let's have a look. Would I win a fight against Gordon Ramsay? To be honest with you, I don't think I'd fight Gordon Ramsay, because Gordon Ramsay always says, you know, the more the fat, the more the flavour. So I think he would find us, you know, if anything, delicious. And finally, this is without... I was just getting sent a load of stuff. People going, oh, I think you're cute. Oh, I think you're sexy. Oh, I've got a crush on you. I mean, I'm not to brag or anything like that, but there was a bit of that in... some other pictures that got sent in Instagram, but we'll not dive into those. And the last one is, would I rather naked wrestle my aunt or my uncle? And I think what it comes down to is, it all depends on who's sellotaping the most pound coins into the annual birthday card. That's the only way. That's the only fair way of deciding which one to do that with. I mean, I do have six or seven aunts or uncles, depending on what gender they want to be that day. So I'll wait till my birthday, see how many pound coins I sell at the tape of the card, and then I'll make a decision from there.
I've got a follow up question with that. Is it the ones that put the most pound coins gets it, or the ones that put the least? Or is that as the mystery?
It's the one that puts the most pound coins on. But if they both put the same amount, it all depends on how many kisses they put on the end. That's the deal breaker.
Fair.
My other half's probably listening to this now, and she's going, what the fuck's he talking about? No, nothing.
It's all right. My other half's in the other room, and she probably hasn't started to hear the question, so probably thank God in that respect. So as far as Wrestling Scotland goes, you've ticked off Varsity Wrestling, you've ticked off WWE.
Yep.
As you said, you mentioned ICW. Is there any companies that you have kept an eye on up here that you want to
maybe
try and get involved with?
The Discovery is a company I wanted to dip my toes into. I've got no idea how to even start that process. I mean, unfortunately, I do a lot of wrestling up in Scotland. I just don't know a lot of people up this end. But Discovery, from what I've seen, just going from what Aspen Faith and Caleb Valhalla has been doing, I love their stuff. I love what they're doing there. And from what I've seen, it looks like a great company to work. It looks like they've got in a load of top guys, a lot of top quality guys. And it looks like they've got some great storylines going at the same time. It's somewhere I would heavily be interested in working. If that ever comes about, great. If not, I wish them all the best in what they're doing, because it looks like they're absolutely smashing it. But yeah, Discovery is the biggest one.
And before we move on to the little social media stuff and we kind of say our goodbyes, you and Shaw Samuels, right? So, both big lads, races.
Yeah.
Has there been comparisons made? Have you ever tried to arrange a braces on a pole match? Has there ever been a?
Yeah, yes, there has actually. When I went, I worked a show for WAW in 2021, and backstage was the first time I'd ever debuted the braces. You know, that's where that promo photo comes on with the shaved chest and everything. And one of the guys, a guy called Bulk, made a comment, and he was like, "Oh, you just look like you look like a fat Shaw Samuels." You know, there's that comparison again. You know what I mean? So I was like, "All right, thanks." You went there. Has anyone ever said that to you? I went, "No, but thanks. That's another person now. Another fat version I can be of someone. Another hero of mine." When I first, the weird thing about this as well is one of the first time I'd ever seen live wrestling as well was at a Comic-Con Expo. That was like 2010. I can't remember who it was F something, and Shaw Samuels was on the show. As long as like Rockstar Spud and things like that, it was the first time I'd ever seen anything like that. And I've always liked the look, but I couldn't pull it off. I didn't think I'd ever pull it off until I got a little bit more trim, still to be the fat version of my mind. But I'd heavily consider doing the braces again at some point if I could pull it off again without being the fat version of him.
You could have trimmed down, and then he started getting all this lean stuff. It's like, how dare you, Shaw? Anyway,
I know.
Anyway, this has been there's been a bit of filth. I think we've kind of kept it on the old PG-13 kind of except the wrestling your auntie or uncle naked. That might have been the one. Or the mention of all the wrong-ins. That might have done it as well. But anyway, for anyone who wants to find out more about Ryan Roode and his filthy ways, where can people find you?
There's Facebook, which should be Pure Filth Wrestling. So facebook.com/, I believe, Pure Filth Wrestling or Pure Filth. On my social media and Instagram is filthy_Ryan_Roode. As you can find us on either, I'm highly active on my Instagram more than I am on my Facebook, but feel free to message us on either for anything at all. You'll never find us on Twitter because it's a shithole.
It is. Perfect. Thank you very much for joining me today.
No worries. Thank you very much, Roman. I do appreciate it.